Welcome to Invented Arizona. I'm Paul Tumarkin.
And I'm Taylor Hudson.
We're with TechLaunch Arizona, the office of the University of Arizona that commercializes inventions stemming from research. Today, we have the pleasure of talking with Dr. Julie Ledford, Assistant Professor of Medicine in her office at the UA's Bio5 Institute. And we're also speaking with Dr. Monica Kraft, Chair of the Department of Medicine, who, as it happens, is traveling today, so we're lucky enough to catch her on the phone between her flights.
Doctors Kraft and Ledford have spent their careers researching asthma and related diseases. Through that research, they've invented a series of peptides that have proven to be useful treatments. So, Monica, tell us more about this research.
Sure. So, before Julie and I came to the University of Arizona, I've been studying asthma, really mechanisms of inflammation and remodeling for many years. And became interested in how the asthmatic airway handles infectious agents, because patients with asthma have a lot of the asthma attacks, and that can lead to hospitalizations, loss of work in school, and in extreme cases, even death. So the asthma exacerbation or the asthma attack is a real problem clinically for patients. And so we wanted to understand better why the asthmatic airway didn't handle infectious agents as well as the normal airway. And so got became interested in the innate immune pathway. So that's the host response to insults. And in this case, we were interested in infection, but you could also think about irritants in the air, pollutants, as well as allergens potentially could also be in that category.
So in one of your recent studies, you compared the levels of surfactant protein A, or SPA, in lean or overweight asthmatics to those of obese asthmatics. Can you tell me a little bit more about those findings?
We found that surfactant protein A, which is a protein that we all make in the lung, and it's really important in host defense, doesn't work as well in asthma. We were actually able to extract it from the airway through a technique where we do bronchoscopy, where we can put a scope in the airway, which is a clinical test we do for patients with asthma, and actually put salt water in, take it out, and actually extract the SPA that way and look at how it functions. And so that made us wonder, well, why is it dysfunctional? Is it a genetic issue, or is it a post-translational issue? The asthmatic airway has a lot of reactive oxygen species. It's a very, obviously, an inflammatory milieu. Does that somehow break down the protein and affect its function? And so we went ahead and sequenced the SPA gene, which is actually made of two peptides, SPA1 and SPA2. And this one polymorphism at position 223 of SPA2 fell out. And at that position, there is a substitution of one amino acid, a glutamine, for a different one, a lysine. And that particular change occurs in about 10% of the population, as high as 30% in African Americans, which is important to us because the prevalence of asthma is much higher in African Americans. And then when we looked at clinical outcomes of asthma, we found that the patients who manifest with asthma had lower lung function, they had worse asthma control by symptoms, and they had more in the way of eosinophils in the airway.
Okay, so let's stop for a minute and take a step back. What are eosinophils, and how are they playing a role here?
Eosinophils are a type of white cell that we associate with allergic inflammation. They're present. They also can do damage to the tissue. And so in asthma, there's just too much of a good thing. We all have eosinophils, but there's too many of them in certain kinds of asthma. And so we think that the dysfunctional SPA, in a sense, contributes to enhancing this inflammation, and therefore may be a mechanism by which patients with asthma are more susceptible to infections. And then when they actually develop them, the SPA doesn't work as effectively to get rid of the pathogen.
Julie, all of this research has culminated in the development of a series of peptides for treating asthma. Given what you know, will we be able to receive this treatment through an inhaler?
I think we're kind of exploring that right now. We're learning a lot about this process. We luckily have met with some wonderful pharmacists here at the University of Arizona that are kind of giving us options of dry powder inhaler versus co-suspensions, and like really how to formulate and test our peptide in the best possible delivery mechanism. So one of the important aspects of it is it needs to be delivered to the distal airway, which is where surfactant's made. So one of our challenges is getting something that's really tiny all the way into the deeper part of the lungs.
Wow, okay, that's a hurdle. But given that you've shown that it works, what kinds of opportunities do you see in applying this treatment to other lung-related diseases?
Definitely from the non-clinical aspect, I think what we see in lab would be applicable to many lung diseases, and that it can reduce mucin production, which is a problem in a lot of airways. And it looks so far in all of our tests, it can reduce airway bronchoconstriction, which would be really important for several different diseases. I just really want people to understand that this is a protein that you already have in your lung that does really great things. Like, it has so many wonderful applications in the lung. This is just a tiny piece of it that potentially asthmatics wouldn't have in a functional state. So we're giving back something that you normally would have in your lungs anyway. We're just giving you back a functional form, and it's highly active, and you're going to get a high dose of this active piece.
Well, Julie Ledford and Monica Kraft from the office in the airport, thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us.
And thanks to all of you for listening to Invented Arizona.
For more information about this invention and all the other great inventions and inventors from the University of Arizona, visit TechLaunch Arizona on the web at techlaunch.arizona.edu.
We are at TechLaunchAZ on Twitter, and you can also find us on Facebook and LinkedIn.
And as always, we invite you to subscribe to our monthly newsletter for stories, updates, and events from around the University of Arizona innovation ecosystem.
You can find that at bit.ly/TLA subscribe. Thanks for listening.